Hello and welcome to a special local edition of Podtoid, Destructoid's video game news podcast, ostensibly. I am here in my living room, which doesn't normally have a large black banner behind me, but today does, because we are celebrating the Game Developers Conference this week, and we also celebrated the 10th year anniversary of Destructoid, which is pretty exciting.
Ridiculous.
It's
unexpected.
The tagline is basically Destructoid 10 years somehow, because you look at every other game site from this era, and you can't anymore because they're closed mostly, out of business,
or they're owned by giant big mega corporations.
Yeah, and like rolled into some weird content mill kind of crap.
Not us though.
No
quality content. 10 years running.
Yeah, right in a fucking dining room. But I have Zack Furniss here.
Hello.
And Brett Makedonski.
Good pronunciation.
They are visiting my home here in lovely San Francisco to help cover the Game Developers Conference.
Sleeping on the couch right over there.
Yeah.
That you can't see and never will.
And we would like to say a special shout out to our good Podtoid pals, Darren and Kyle, who couldn't be with us this week.
Maybe but Hayden a little bit.
We wish them the best. So, this is basically the end of GDC. It goes on through tomorrow, but we've done all of our appointments. There's more games that we haven't seen, but, you know, three people in a large conference can only do so many things. But I think we should just start with some highlights from the show. Sure. What have you seen? What do you like?
Things I can talk about?
Yes.
That's not breaking your rules. A good one for me was Chasm that I was telling... Or no, I keep saying that. It's not Chasm. It's Chronos. The VR one that had the fixed camera angle that was very Resident Evil in that you're like looking into a room and you can look back and forth and whatnot. And a lot of people complaining about their neck hurting, so maybe I'm in the minority on that one. But
I played that too and my neck hurt.
Yeah.
So you're strong-necked.
Yeah, well, we were talking about that earlier. Brett says that probably means that he's more flexible than I am. I was like, I don't think that's how it works. If your neck hurts, isn't that backwards?
I don't understand. How did you come to that conclusion?
I turn all conversations where I may have a weakness into it being
advantage,
a strength.
Ah, okay. It goes back to, look, this whole trip, every time I say something that's probably true, that's what he says. He's like, you're probably right. That's Brett. That's what I learned about Brett on this trip.
I'm giving you credit. And
no, you're giving me partial credit.
Yeah, you know, like possible, you know what? You're probably right.
Yeah, exactly.
He does do that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Exactly.
So we were walking to the corner store right before this podcast.
Are we going into this already?
And some dude is like looking to get us to sign petitions, right? And we normally just very polite or whatever, but not Zach. Zach pretended that he was mute.
Yeah.
And started fucking with this Greenpeace dude.
Why? Why?
Because I don't want to pretend that I'm invisible.
How do you pretend you're mute?
You don't talk. It's not that hard.
Okay. Well, I mean, I don't know if you're like adding additional pantomime.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. No, that's exactly yes. Like a mime. I was like, yeah. And he's like, well, we're trying to save the whales, so you want to talk a little bit? I was like.
I mean, I assume they have literature that you could read.
Yeah,
I
sure.
Mean, so that doesn't really get you out of anything.
No, it didn't. It was just to have fun with it. So I was listening to him. I was like.
Then we got right into the, for the audio only folks, mm-hmm. Zach was not talking there. The video people get it.
Zach was pretending to be mute.
Yes. See, anyway, it's not that hard.
And then, like, the dude just got down to brass tacks. He's like, hey, for just 30 cents, like donations are the best way to help.
For
and
just so, 2 and Zach, cents a day, you can save a coral reef.
So Zach pulls out his wallet and, like 30 cents, whatever. Dude's like, no, 30 cents a day. So if you could just get your credit card information. And he relayed again that he cannot talk. And we went into the bougie-ass corner store and bought cheese.
Yeah, like, I had a little notebook, and I was like, I don't have any money. And he's like, just 30 cents a day times 31. Like, I was like, no.
Wait, someone do the math on that quickly. I don't think anyone can do the math on
$9.30 a month.
That's a weird amount of money to ask people for.
You don't know, you don't know if I made it up or not, because... you're not good at math or geography.
So video games, Brett, did you see anything that was surprisingly good?
No.
Did you see anything that was expectantly good?
Yes. Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles by Platinum Games was really dope.
I've heard tell it's basically them reskinning the Transformers game that they did.
I didn't play Transformers, but I heard that Transformers was really good. But Ninja Turtles is also really good.
So you played it?
Yeah.
Okay.
With like the creator.
Kamiya?
Oh no.
Oh wait, well, he's not working
making
on that.
He's doing Scalebound.
He's finishing Scalebound. Who's making the Turtles?
Then a Japanese name that starts with an S.
Okay, so talk about it a little bit. Action game.
Yeah.
One player. Do you one turtle? There's four of the turtles, and there's one of you. How did that work?
You get to be one of the turtles.
Okay.
Which is probably an expected twist. You could pick Leonardo or Donatello or Raphael or Michelangelo.
Oh, you can pick them all four.
But only one. Anyway, so like you get into fights. Oh, I kicked over my Coke. You get into fights with like the.
He means cola, non-branded cola.
So you get into
drugs.
You get into fights with the foot soldiers, and
literally
each different interaction is kind of like graded, like in Bayonetta style or whatever.
Okay.
And it's just like this like really fucking fast, awesome flurry of so like every time Michelangelo like swings his nunchucks or whatever, it's like this orange streak across the screen, and the enemies are making streaks. It's just like this like really colorful firework type like fighting aesthetic that looks super neat, and it's just a two button combo thing, a light attack, heavy attack.
Okay.
And then you can get into all these team attacks. Everyone has a special, like, Michelangelo will...
Oh, so they're fighting around with you, and you're one of them.
Yeah, we had four people in the demo, though, so it was all people for us.
But, oh, so you can do it co-op, though.
This will upset some people, but not local co-op, only online multiplayer.
So they had four of you in a room playing online multiplayer.
Land, Halo style.
Right.
Okay. Yeah, Platinum was pretty adamant that they don't want to compromise their 60 frames per second, and rendering that four times over on the same machine would...
I feel like action gamers will want their 60 frames per second, but from the two-button combo, four turtles, it doesn't seem like it's going to be a Bayonetta, Devil May Cry level of like intense action, and maybe more of just like a fun brawler action.
So it like I really like the look of the game, and I don't think I would want to see that like in a quarter of my screen.
Sure, sure.
It's one of those things that looks real good on my whole TV.
Like, did you feel like you were executing things, like, and there was no higher way to like perform even better, or did you see anyone else play who was like very good at the game?
Well,
or,
like, I mean,
did
like, they look the lead better? Designer was very good at the game.
Okay,
yes.
So there was like a skill gulf that was like obvious, that like people who like the hardcore action games will be like. Still okay with that?
I think so. So the dynamic that I couldn't quite grasp, because I mean I can do like light attack, heavy attack, like that's video games, we've done that, was the getting into co-op moves with like another turtle doing like a duo thing, and then also doing their special moves. There's at least four of them, but there may have been eight. It might be four special and four co-op. Couldn't quite tell there, but yeah, like the special moves are cool because it'll help the team, but it's just like one person doing it. So for instance, like Michelangelo, he'll pull out some pom poms. He'll be a cheerleader. He'll cheer the team on, and that'll refill everyone's special meter. Or like Leonardo can just straight up slow down time, puts this gray filter over the screen, and you can just like go to town because the other dudes are hardly moving.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then so we played in Manhattan. Like a piece of the city, and it's like kind of open world, but I think after you beat each stage, you're gonna go to a different like turtles locale.
Okay.
So like you have like open world Manhattan, and then like maybe you'll go to the sewers, and maybe that'll be more on rails because sewers kind of lend themselves to that.
Sure. So it kind of seems like a natural evolution of like the Turtles in Time, like Super Nintendo era four player brawlers.
That's what I'm hoping, man. I'm hoping like you go down to the turtles and down to the sewers and like the Rat King's down there, and you do some Rat King shit, you know. I hope they follow some of that stuff. So we did a little bit of city stuff, and then Splinter was like, Bebop's in the bank robbing it, and we're like, oh shit, we gotta go do that. So we go to the bank, and Bebop's in there, and he's got this big ass like chainsaw, like this neon yellow chainsaw. that he's like swinging around, and he has 7 health bars, which is a lot more than we had. And so we're just like fighting. It's a brawler. It's simple. And so we're doing that, and he's kind of kicking our ass. And when you run out of health, you start bouncing around on your shell. And waiting for a teammate to come revive you. You have like 7 seconds, 10 seconds, whatever. If nobody gets to you, you drop down into a sewer minigame where you're like in your turtle den with just a heaping pile of pizza in front of you. And you have to mash a button to eat pizza as quick as you can, but you can't eat the pizza too fast or else it'll burn the roof of your mouth. So it's like this, you got to go like 85% type of thing and figure that out. And then once you do that, you get back into the game. But if all 4 turtles are in the pizza room at the same time, the run wipes and you have to start over.
I think Kyle would miss your roof, the roof of the mouth. But that roof. is a cute...
How should I say it? Roof.
The roof.
The roof.
Roof.
The roof is on fire.
But I like that minigame. That actually sounds pretty dope.
Yeah, it's really cool.
So if we can kind of scale back for a second, just talk about GDC in the general for the people who don't know. Mm-hmm. This is the 30th annual Game Developers Conference.
Really?
Somehow, I don't really understand.
I thought it was like 4 because I've been to 3, yeah. And I assume it started right before I started coming.
Yeah, this is the first one. So imagine there's 30 more of these.
Yeah,
like,
this
that's
is
exhausting.
My 4th, I think. But so it's basically there's like 3 large buildings in downtown San Francisco, 2 of which are connected, and they are just multi-use venues.
Convention center.
Yeah.
It's a convention center.
And so it's a developer-focused, like professional industry-level show as compared to like E3 where you're walking down corridors with fucking like neon lights and bumping the same fucking 4 songs over and over.
It's much more muted, and the whole idea of the show is for developers to learn. They go to panels, they go to talks.
Yeah, and to meet other collaborators.
It's part job fair too, so yeah.
Yeah, so it's very business heavy, and it's not like this big pomp and circumstance thing. And then there's a lot of like off-site meetings because there's companies who will just rent out a hotel room and be like, actually, you know, I wrote an article on Detroit last year when I went to see Life is Strange about how Square Enix was like, yeah, we have this space to come preview the game, but you have to take off your shoes.
They rented like an Airbnb.
Yeah. So
that was the rule of the Airbnb is no shoes.
So I did which socks should I wear because Square Enix is making me take off my shoes. But I went back to see a couple of games today and it was at that damn place and I had to take my shoes off again and I was not wearing fly socks.
People laugh?
I was almost kicked out, you know, once I took the shoes off and they're like, oh.
It was on account
socks?
Of the beard and hair,
is that really a thing?
No, they did not almost kick me out.
Okay, I was going to say, are they really that discriminatory of socks? Is that a thing?
No, I was actually there to see the expansion for Kingdom, which is a strategy game that plays out on a like 2-dimensional plane. You can basically only go left or right. And aside from left and right and a sprint button for your horse, because you are the king or queen of the kingdom, everything is done with 1 button press. You just tap a button to drop coins.
You reviewed that recently, right?
I reviewed that a few months ago.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's really good. There were some things that really kind of bothered me about it.
Mm-hmm.
And they're releasing an expansion. They're releasing an expansion. They're also patching it next week to fix some things that kind of bugged me, like the AI units would never run, and now they have running animations, and it's like, thank God, some sense of urgency when like my fucking hours of time is being destroyed and you assholes are sitting there just kind of walking it off. There's also the expansion though is going to come in conjunction with the Xbox release, and instead of just this one land, your kind of goal will be to get to the very end where there's a harbor and to build a boat and then to boat yourself off to another place. So it's basically they're kind of like cutting off their own end game and then just going further. So I'm really excited about that. Every new addition that they're bringing in looks great, and it's a kind of a way to make it so you don't play that game where because you get to a point in that game where you know the best way, because you always start from scratch. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's kind of, it's not a roguelike, but like in that sense, you're kind of starting over every time, and you know what is the best way to do whatever you're trying to do.
Yeah.
So like the first like 30 minutes become really boring the Minecraft after a problem. While. I've never played Minecraft.
It's a similar thing. You're like, I know how to build all these things, but now I have to do it again and again. Or don't starve. It's like that beginning 2 hours or so is like, got to rush through that same thing. It gets really monotonous.
Yeah, yeah. So, and they're addressing that and a few other issues, and that's really cool. Mm-hmm. I also played a platformer there that is kind of, also again, kind of like roguelike, Spelunky inspired. Has a lot of Super Meat Boy in the like wall sliding and everything. And Downwell was like a big visual inspiration. There's actually one guy, there's one sound guy who does music and sound design, both of which were really good. And then there's one guy just, you know, coding and game design and all the art, and it's fucking beautiful. I don't even remember the name of it off the top of my head right now, which kind of sucks. And I wouldn't even know how to find it. No, it's this. Anyways, I don't know.
All right,
you are this little man, this little blob thing. And you get these different heads that give you kind of different abilities, different amount of health or whatever. You pick up your backpack and you pick a gun. There's like a regular kind of standard pop, pop. And it actually has like a pop gun sound. There's like a shotgun and there's a laser rifle. And I don't know. It's fucking game is gorgeous. Really fun to play. There's also, the developer showed me a secret. So there's this whale who is, quote, the your only friend in the universe, for the friend of the character. And you can't understand the whale because it's a whale and it just makes whale sounds at you, but like you give the whale stuff you find while you're playing the game, and like the whale will give you upgrades.
Okay.
But yeah, so you can kind of like rocket jump yourself on top of the whale and then go around the whale, and then its butt is made of snakes, and then you go in the snake butts, and then you can find a secret poop head. All it does is make your character brown. All it does is make your character brown and give you a poop head, which is pretty sweet.
Yeah, it sounds useful.
I'm into it.
Yeah. You done with that one?
Yeah.
I was going to say, mentioning roguelikes, I forgot to talk about Star Mazer, which I played also. That one.
So, Star Mazer, kickstarted, really popular, whatever. But then there's like all these Star Mazer collaborations. Mm-hmm. So, is this like the Star Mazer? Is this one of the Star Mazer adjacent properties?
Yeah, now so this one's called Star Mazer DSP. I could be wrong in that abbreviation, but I think it's DSP. What's up?
DSP?
Yes. But it's kind of like a Gradius type of a side-scrolling shooter kind of thing going on. And it's roguelike as well. So you pick your ships and everything in the beginning, and you say, I want this one because it has these abilities, and I want this one. And then when they die, you just move right into the next person. But it's kind of randomized, so you don't know who you're going to get next. So you're flying through these Raiden-style levels, and it's tough.
Raiden?
Yeah, he called it Raiden. I was thinking it was Raiden, but then the developer said Raiden, so I was like, I'm going to stick with that, because he's used this as inspiration for a very long time.
Okay.
But I don't know. But it's really cool, and I'm the first person to ever defeat the boss in the game, so I'm feeling pretty good about that.
Oh, wow.
He's like, this is so amazing to watch somebody play it, because we've only played it in the studio. I've like, nobody can beat it, even in the studio, so you did it. Good job. So.
Wait, yeah. The developers can't beat it?
Well, I think they eventually did, but they were saying they, even before they came to the show, they were talking about, maybe we should make it a little easier. Is it supposed to be impossible right now? But it's good stuff. I'm looking forward to seeing more of it. It's supposed to be basically like a prelude to Star Mazer itself. So
okay,
yeah,
yeah. There's I mean, we all probably saw like five to eight games a day for the last week.
But so, 20 or so total, maybe more.
Yeah, and of course at GDC, there's also, because of this developer focus, there's a lot of really cool talks, which we mostly didn't get to see, because that's like, hey, I can listen to a presentation for an hour or two that doesn't really give anything for the folks at home. So we had to kind of prioritize just actual game demos.
I mean, sometimes news comes out of those and postmortems or something like that. Like, for instance, last year we went to an Alien Isolation postmortem, and they showed footage of what the game was like when it was third person instead of first person. And that seemed to be really popular. A lot of people want to see that. So there is for us there, but we just don't usually
So we basically have to prioritize from the panels and like pick out a few generalist ones and say, okay, like this is definitely, you know, something that not only like our readers will like, but also like that we will be interested in, because like I don't fucking care about DirectX 12 fucking cloud server, whatever, you know, like there's a lot of super jargon heavy technical panels and all that.
I was walking behind some marketing bro earlier today, and he was pitching this other guy on all the system solutions or something like that that he could help him out with, and I refrained from telling him what a terrible person he was.
Please, sir, do you have a solution to my system? I walked by right out in front of the convention center on the corner. There was some dude handing out like cards, and he was just going, "Indie dev party tonight at a strip club." And I'm like, okay, is that some, like that was like a really like positive appeal? Like, hey, it's not just any indie dev party; it's at a strip club. And I'm like, oh god, that just sounds awful. Why would anyone want to go to that?
I mean, we could go report on it.
Yeah.
See our first bare breasts.
Well, no? Hey, second, because there's two of them.
Oh, that's true. First and second in ones.
Yeah, no, the last couple of days of the show have been really good for me in terms of seeing a cool game, because yesterday I got to play Tooth and Tail.
That's what I was trying to say, yeah.
Which is a real-time strategy game, but like specifically designed to be like the antithesis to a StarCraft kind of RTS. And that, I feel like, is evidence enough just by the fact that I literally picked it up and immediately knew how to play without having to fucking figure shit out. Mm-hmm.
We need to take a quick 1 minute break.
Yes.
Apparently, or, Mr. Producer says so.
Or we're supposed to take a break in 1 minute, in which case we fucked up horribly.
Oh. Yeah,
it's that one. Oh, no.
Then we're not going to take a break.
Oh, no.
Tell us when that minute passes by.
Is something on fire? What's going on?
Tooth and Tail, anyways, is from the developers of Monaco. Mm-hmm. And Monaco is a fucking awesome game that I really like.
What's yours is mine.
True. And so it is a competitive... there is a single player, but it is competitive focused. And... it basically kind of simplifies everything to work on a controller, for one. It is coming to PC, and you can use the mouse and keyboard, but it's like, instead of trying just to transmit crazy RTS shit onto a controller, it's just like, we're going to just invent our own new thing. And so it's random stages and fog of war, and the best part, I'm going to tell you about it in a little bit once we find some more tape.
We got to, Zach's got to take a big poop, so we'll be right back.
That is not what's going to happen.
Tooth and motherfucking Tail, we are back. Right? Yeah, that's what we were talking about.
Yep,
that's
we are back.
And we are back. So, Tooth and Tail is a strategy game, real time. And it is competitive, and it has randomly generated maps, and they are not symmetrical. And that's kind of the cool thing. So instead of learning a map, like you would do with a MOBA or whatever, and like just knowing where everything is, you can actually start disadvantaged in a game. But because it's real-time strategy games that only last 5 to 10 minutes instead of, like, an hour, you know, that could be a more interesting experience. That could spur you on to trying new tactics. I mean, it's actually pretty cool. And, of course, like, all the fucking animals, it's, like, all World War I-themed animals fighting over resources. That resource is being meat, as in, like, whoever gets the win... is like prey and gets eaten, and whoever, you know, doesn't win is...
Are they animal cannibals?
Animal cannibals.
Are they?
No,
squirrels eat
kinds of animals.
Species,
so you
right?
get like snakes, and they're good like anti-aircraft guys because they have a range
makes projection. Makes sense, Zach. Go
okay.
with it.
I was going to say, like the ground dweller.
There's owls, and those guys are fucking assholes because if you can... So there's like different tiers of things you build. And you also start with one base, and you build farms around it, which are tended to by pigs. And those pigs then, are you able to build more farms, you're able to get more economy and get more money. And then you use that to build like little wardens that hold all your different troops. And it costs different tier amounts. And at any time you can destroy something and get the money back if you need it. So basically, yeah, you're going to start throwing around like little lizards that are really fast and ferrets and squirrels have guns, I think, so they can get off little pot shots. And then you start getting to higher level animals and you get like a boar with a fucking like area of effect flamethrower and just wrecking shit. I had some badgers that were like doing work for sure in the second game I played. And the craziest thing, though, is really that, like, because it's a 2D isometric pixel art, and all of it was fucking made by one person, and that person must be dead now, or have a hand, like, that is permanently a pencil, or, like, permanently a mouse, you know? Like, I have no fucking idea how that game looks that good. And it's the same artist who did Monaco. But, like, from Monaco's very simple pixels, it's fucking...
I was going to say, what's his name? Johnny Pencilhand? And then and then I was like, I probably don't need to interrupt him to say that.
You did anyway.
I mean, and also after I already corrected myself to say that if he's drawing pixel art, he's probably not using a pencil.
We misfired that whole segment.
I'm just going to back away from that one.
But yeah, and then there's also one additional artist who did all the character portraits, and it's just cool to see, like, you go through the single player, and you can talk to every single animal, and they'll give you little, like, flavor dialogue, and this one guy is like, yeah, the fucking squirrels, they're a bunch of drunks, but, you know, they'll fight for you. It's like, yeah, those fucking lush squirrels. So, yeah.
Like, it's a weird game, because how do you choose which animal has that trait? Like, I would never picture squirrels as the drunk ones, or the snakes attacking the owls, but, you know, I mean, I guess.
Yeah, yeah. So yeah, it's really cool. I'm excited to see what they do with it. Apparently it's already, there's people playing hundreds of hours in it and doing crazy shit.
Cool.
In like private alphas and whatnot. And it's, I'm pretty jazzed for it. And you know, one thing I am not jazzed for, and we've talked about this on Podtoid before, is virtual reality.
At all?
No.
Hate it?
I
You want reality.
I like my reality real and my coffee black.
Black.
Ah!
Why is our producer a detriment to the show? He just made all. Can they hear the reverb, or can we only hear the reverb?
Oh no, they can hear.
They
it.
Know what's going yeah. on. You know,
he's gonna do all like the studio stupid tricks. You're gonna hear like the fart noises and. Yeah, we're gonna not. Missed it.
We're gonna just basically devolve into like shock DJs and like public radio.
Yeah.
But yeah, I don't like virtual reality, and GDC actually is like billing this year's show as like
the year of it.
They're billing it as like it's the Game Developers Conference / Virtual Reality Conference, and I'm like, where the fuck did that come from? And I don't know. You've played something in VR you liked, which you already talked about, Chronos.
Yeah, Chronos is good.
And you saw a bunch of VR stuff.
I did.
You know, don't sound enthused about it.
They probably co-branded it as like GDC and the VR DC or whatever, because like all the game developers are developing for virtual reality. It makes sense.
Sure.
But it's.
Did you get pink eye from all the headsets that people tried to shove into your face?
Oh, it wasn't from the headsets, buddy. I don't know. VR is kind of annoyingly everywhere this year, and it has been in the past. But it's so many of the emails we got leading up to GDC are all just, come see this new VR game we're making, and there's no real way to filter what's worth our time and what's maybe not great.
Right. What is worth putting on a headset, getting the fucking face sweats, getting your big-ass nose to fucking not fit on the headsets, and then there's always a little bit of light underneath and I can fucking see down, which is not putting me immersed in virtual reality. I mean, that's not the only reason. I don't dislike VR just because I have a large nose. I dislike VR because it's like the best possible VR headset right now is basically the fucking... is it Vive or Reeve?
Fact check?
Vive.
Yeah. So, yeah, the fucking Vive, and that's like, what, $800?
It's actually pronounced 6-5-E. Roman, it's a Roman numeral joke.
Yeah.
And that's like $800, and you need a fucking high end PC. Yeah. So you're probably gonna go buy a new graphics card for like 200-300 bones, and it's like,
and like an empty warehouse worth of space to play in.
Right. I mean, that's the other thing. I mean, we have a surprisingly large living situation for San Francisco, and like even then, like we'd have to move the fucking coffee table and
pretty much
and
this
push some chairs.
Right here is the only one that would work for you. If you just put that table in there,
yeah,
it's like
take
perfect
this,
vibe space. Yeah.
Just this is my dedicated VR room now.
Exactly.
I don't have a dining room.
People are gonna have dedicated VR rooms.
They are.
Oh, well, I mean,
people in the Midwest,
yeah.
Like middle America.
Probably people with more money than sense.
Well, I mean, a lot of sense adds up to a lot of money.
Yeah, they have more money than cents.
Yeah, but 100 cents is a dollar.
I got cents.
Yeah.
But I'm not a censor.
Which is like a small amount of legal tender censor that can be traded for goods and services. Or they got dollar bill, y'all. I don't know, man. So I've been banging this drum, and like people are like, so some people are finally chilling on VR, and some people are like vehemently disagreeing with me. But for me, it's like you can create a cool VR experience that's like 20-30 minutes, and then you get that shit off, and like that's fine, that's cool, that's neat, it's novel. It's not going to be a mainstream appeal for a really long time, if ever. But I don't want to fucking sit in one of those things for 6 hours. Like, that's disgusting.
So I can kind of speak to that a little bit. When we were saying, like, we don't know what's worth our time, what's not worth our time, what probably is worth our time is this big Oculus event where they bring 30 games to it that they're obviously showcasing because they're, like, releasing tomorrow or whenever it is. And these are like 30 games worth checking out, and we had time with six of them just kind of randomly or something like that. And I played VR for 2 hours almost consecutively. Like, it was like 30 minute demos and then like off to the next door to do the next one, so it was like a couple minutes in between. I was sick of using VR by the time that those 2 hours were over. It fatigued me. Yeah. The games I played were, there was like this Hearthstone-like card deck game, which isn't really my forte. I don't know a whole lot about that kind of stuff. So that was just sort of like the dev trying to not beat me when we were playing against one another, but almost his hand falling in such a way that he was forced to beat me. And then he's like, oh, next appointment's here, let's go.
I when I was playing Tooth and Tail, I played against the lead designer first, and like I was still figuring everything out and got my ass kicked pretty okay. And Austin Wintory, who won the Grammy for the Journey soundtrack and is a now big name video game composer, is doing the music for that, and he was there, and he mentioned how Andy Schatz, like who runs the studio, just like has no mercy. He just kicks everyone's ass at the game. Like, he doesn't even try. So, and then I was like, okay. And then before we left, he was like, oh, you want to play Andy one time? And I was like, okay, cool. And I had coaching from the designer to kind of help me out. And it ended up being like a really, like, abnormally long match. But I won. And then I was very suspicious because, like, you trumped up the fact that, like, he's so good and always kicks everyone's ass. And, like, why did I win? So, I don't know.
Savant.
I mean, I am the guy who, you know, like, beats Dark Souls 3 bosses for the first time without dying. The resident Souls expert of Destructoid.
And how many actually of the Souls games have you finished?
How many are there?
There's going to be a third one, and Bloodborne pretty much counts.
What about Demon Souls?
And Demon Souls, okay, there you go.
Okay.
Yeah.
I've finished none of them. Zero of them.
That's what I thought.
I started with Demon Souls. Yeah. I was on the ground floor. I didn't sure finish it.
I know you played them.
And Dark Souls 2, I played for like 30 hours, and I was like, I'm done.
Yeah.
And I've barely been able to fuck with Bloodborne yet.
Yeah.
Did you know that those games have like this big iconic screen that said, you died? Have you ever seen that?
Did you know, if you watch closely, that Homer is actually Bart's father?
Anyway, so in a roundabout way, I'm at this Oculus event, and I go to a second game, which is kind of this neat idea. You are a, I don't know what the fuck you are. I have no idea what you are, but you can teleport.
Man.
You can teleport into synths and like
robots.
Yeah, like these robots, okay. Robot soldier dudes who are shooting. They look
like the Bruce Willis classic film Surrogates.
They look a lot like the Geth from Mass Effect, is what they look like. And it's called
Geth. Enter the Gecko.
Jesus Christ!
See, you're talking about VR, and all I
go to your
do
room.
Is
go to your room.
I could do that very easily.
It's called Damage Core. You teleport into different synths who are like attacking your soldiers, and then you like turn on them and you start shooting them, and you're pretty weak because they're just foot soldiers. All these guys are pretty weak, and once you start to die, you know, it kind of does one of those like screen getting progressively redder and smaller type of deals, you quickly look at another synth and you teleport into him.
Okay.
And then you can even go kill your old self. It doesn't even matter. And you just...
I would love to kill my old self. Also my current self.
You just keep doing that. And it's a very on-rails experience, but it has a little bit of a hook that makes it feel maybe like it's a bit more authored, even though it's really not. It's kind of an illusion. And that game was okay. And then I played Kronos.
Kronos, yeah.
Like Zach did, and I didn't really like it as much as he did, so he talked about it. And
it hurt your neck.
It did, because like the screen makes you go like, I need to talk to the mic still, don't I?
Yeah.
The screen makes you look like way over here, and then you do some stuff, and you're looking like way over here.
It's such bullshit. I keep hearing that, but literally it was this for me. A little to the right, a little to the left, and it was the full range of motion.
It could have been some sort of hardware thing. Like my first demo, all the text was kind of blurry, and I thought it was my bad eyes.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. No.
And then I realized that if I would have fucked with the headset a little bit more, it would have come in focus.
Yeah.
Maybe it's just Zach has a very strong neck.
That's not true. That's very not true.
Anyway, and I played Rock Band VR also, which is it's neat. You're up on a stage, you're looking out, and there's a very dark venue because it's a rock venue. You can see like two rows of people who are all like, yeah,
that's him dancing and pumping his fist.
Yeah,
it's kind of like in that weird dumb video game way where they're definitely having fun. You can see like the exit lights at the back of the venue.
They look like a father dancing to a Miley Cyrus song because he got dragged to the concert.
But if the father was like a hip cute girl, yes. Anyway, and you like look around, you see your bassist. Your bassist like will do stuff, like interact with you, come over, dance on you a little bit. You look back at like
that sounds weird. I don't know if I like that.
Well, just like. Like one of those very Rock Band like synergy type moments.
Right.
You look down at your pedal board and do some stuff there. They put the Oculus Touch controller on the Rock Band guitar, so that essentially becomes like in the game, and you can when you're playing, you see the frets that you're pushing down like light up in this just kind of really cool looking way. And my big problem with that, and I hope Harmonix is going to address it or work on something, is the way you play is you look down at your stage monitors, but you're basically forced to look down at the stage monitors the entire time.
Basically, I gotcha. Like a bass guitar. Oh man, you're trying to slide these under my nose, like just because I'm exhausted from 4 days of fucking not sleeping that I'm not going to get those jokes.
Your pun game is strong as ever.
it's like sentient. It just fucking.
So you're supposed to like be doing this rock performance, and I mean the idea is that you are a famous musician and you're playing your songs in front of all these people, but you're stuck looking down at these two monitors as you know, which isn't what a rocker would do. You're basically
I'm sorry, are you a rocker? Are you
a
professional?
Little bit. We sang some songs last night.
I mean, like
more
where?
So than you.
Yeah, that's true.
Oh.
You didn't have anything to say.
It's not a pun. I'm too tired to do any other kind of joke.
I'm assuming they're working on making that experience a little bit better. It's guitar only, like no other instruments. Sure.
So it's Guitar Hero.
Kind of. I asked him, like, what kind of career progression type thing are you going to do? Are you just going to go back to, like, the Guitar Hero, work your way down the set list type of deal? And they're like, oh, we're not really sure yet. We're still working on that type of stuff.
Are they releasing it as a separate game?
As I understand it, yes.
Ugh.
And, definitely yes, because the set list they're looking at is 55 to 75 songs, which is basically a full Rock Band game. I don't know if it's going to be, like, a $60 game or what, but it might have to be if they're getting new music, which I'm not, they haven't said if they're doing that yet, or if it's existing library, and it's a thing. It's okay. I
honestly just feel like virtual reality kind of has, you know, like people who are making the technology are into it, so they're like, oh, cool, and then the press is kind of just buying into it and being like, yeah, this is cool, but like fucking two people are going to own these things in a little bit, so I don't know. I'm so damn tired from the Game Developers Conference. It's not just that, like, we're working, you know, like 12-hour days, but it's then, like, we, you know, feel the need to reward ourselves after that and go out in the evening. And it's probably a bad...
It's a bad call. Every
bad
time.
Idea. We had to go out because, you know, what are you going to do? Not
work? Stay home and work?
There were two nights where I was like, I think I'm just going to stay home and work. And Brett's like, don't you want to go out? I'm like, no, not really.
But here's the thing, right? If we decided to stay home and work and not go out, for example, last night, I would not have seen Young MC and Sir Mix-a-Lot fucking perform at some weird-ass venue with, like, barely clothed women on stilts walking around,
and a Michael Jackson impersonator,
a
really good, one actually,
and like a light skinned Michael Jackson impersonator.
Okay,
and like important some like weird spaceman guy. The stilts were throwing me off because I'm like, I'm at face level with all of these asses.
Yeah,
like I'm gonna turn around and just get a face full of
nose in the butt.
Yep. That, when we first walked in, I was like, oh, and that's happening.
Yeah, it was weird, man. There's a lot of weird parties, and then of course there's like the Game Developer Awards, which is a weird party in and of itself, because they're like,
because we make it a weird party
because somehow for some reason we are apparently fun enough that they just keep moving us closer and closer and like enabling us to kind of lump all the troublemakers into one table. We've told the story how last year Brett and I snuck in a bunch of tall cans of Foster's and an entire bottle of vodka and a bottle of orange juice.
Like, where did you sneak that into? That like was just in bag?
We put it in Hayden's backpack.
It in. Oh, okay. We put it in a backpack and just walked in with it.
Got it.
This time, I actually showed up at the awards late, so it had been like 10 minutes started, and I forgot my GDC badge at home. And I walked into the thing, and the woman like just would not let me in. And I was like, I have my like VIP wristband that like says I'm supposed to be in there. And she's like, okay, but you can't be in here because you don't have this other thing. So even though you're supposed to be inside the thing that's inside this thing, I'm not gonna let you in. And I was like, wow, you suck. And I turned around, walked around the corner, went in a different entrance, and just walked in. So
security.
That was fun. I also, because I was late and because we didn't get to really prep it and didn't, you know, show up with a backpack full of Foster's and vodka, I drank like two bottles of wine because there's wine at the tables. And I had finished literally my last sip of the wine and set it down on the table, and just the stem breaks. Like the fucking wine glass just breaks. And I'm like, now we just look even worse. We're just horrible.
We weren't looking to look good in the first place, though. So I think you got us further to our goal than we would have otherwise been.
That's true. But yeah, that was a pretty low key affair. There was a nice tribute to Iwata in the in memoriam section, which is pretty nice.
But do you know what was not a low key affair? Jesus Christ. What the fuck?
Okay, so two nights ago is when we had our party, kind of formally celebrating 10 years of Destructoid. And again, it was at a much more clubby venue.
Mm-hmm.
And wow, you could feel the bass of the music in your lungs. Like, it was way too loud.
That's not hyperbole. That's...
Yeah, no, it was like...
That's literal.
It was so weird. Yeah, it was incredibly loud. It was our party, so we were on like a VIP list or whatever, and there's like a VIP section ostensibly that it wasn't really a VIP section. There was just an area with couches that was roped off, and no one was there. And I was just like, I need to sit down because I'm walking 12 miles a day and my feet hurt. So we just kind of sat on the couches and then kind of turned it into a VIP area.
And then people got scared to walk around the rope.
Well, there was a weird moment where a friend of the show, Hayden Dingman, and I walked up to the couches for the first time, and we moved the rope to get in. But as soon as we did that, some random dude, I don't know, just followed us in there and sat down with us. And I was like, oh no. And then I was like, okay, now I want to close the rope again so more people don't start funneling up here. But it's going to be really weird because I'm like locking that guy in, even though it's just a fucking velvet rope.
That's false imprisonment. He could probably sue you for that.
Probably.
I'm like, I don't want to be an asshole and be like, yeah, I'm going to close this off so now you feel really uncomfortable. But I didn't want other people in
there. I would have doubled down on asshole, and I would have been... I would have opened the rope up and been like, you need to leave now, and then just put the rope back.
And I believe that.
Yeah, no, yeah. That's a Brett move.
Yeah.
But, you know, it was a blast.
At night, you got to see the Brett moves.
more than I wanted to see it.
I still don't. I mean, I don't know who packed everything up, because I fucking certainly did not.
Yeah, you did. It was you and me. We packed up almost everything.
Oh shit! I helped pack up too.
Yeah. It all ended up in my car. There's still a bunch of like clamps for like lighting rigs in my passenger seat, like at the feet.
Not to be confused with the clamps for nipples.
Yeah,
there's a bunch of those in there too.
Yeah,
yeah.
But no, I literally, while we were sitting down to record this show, I was like, "Oh, I'm sitting on something hard. That hurts." And I reached, and it was in my back pocket, was like this weird piece of plastic. And I was like, "Oh, maybe it was on the chair." And I sat down and it like wriggled into my pocket. That's weird. I put it down. Then Kenny setting it up was like, I'm missing like a screw clamp thing. And I was like, here's one. And apparently, according to Zach, I put that in my pocket like 3 nights ago.
Yeah.
And had been sitting on it for 3 days and not noticed until now.
Yeah. I was like, hey,
also not changing your jeans, apparently.
Yeah.
No, hell no.
I was like, I still have a knob here. And you're like, oh, I'll just take that. And you just like dropped in your ass. And then you didn't know for 3 days.
But yeah,
yeah,
man.
I don't remember that.
It was neat seeing that many people out having that good of a time all for this dumb little
upset. So when we got there, which was like, wait, it was like 20 minutes before it even opened, because we were, you know, it was our party and we could just go in. But even when we got there, the line was halfway down the block and then down a full block and like a little bit more. And when people were coming in after the fact, they were reporting that it was like down like two or three blocks, people were waiting in line. Mm-hmm. So yeah, it was a tremendous show of support, and it wasn't, it was an open, essentially an open party, like people could show up. But we also had a lot of people who were, you know, longtime, Destructoid kind of people we're close with in the industry.
Former employees.
Former Destructoid writers, of course. And just, yeah, like community members and it was nice.
Did I tell you about my dumb moment where, because we had a shirtless Mr. Destructoid walking around the whole time, kind of dancing and everything.
With a
buff ass dude.
Laser gun.
Yes. Well, he was standing up at the photo booth and I was like, I've had a couple drinks. You know, it'd be a funny photo. Take it off my shirt and get next to him. That was a bad idea.
You did that?
Yeah.
Why didn't you tell me that?
You were downstairs. I couldn't find you guys for an hour.
Since then.
Yeah, you were gone for a while.
I was down looking for you guys for about an hour, walking in circles, and could not find you.
We were doing coke in the bathroom.
Yeah, no,
We were in the same, well, I guess we weren't in the same place the whole time.
No.
We ended up in the cocaine room for a while.
Yeah, no, because you grabbed me by the shoulder, and you're like, hey, I'm going to go to the VIP area behind the DJ. So I was like, all right. I went over there, didn't see anybody.
I did not tell you that. That's
the word you said, and you end up going in a different place that I didn't know about.
I don't, there's nothing, there isn't even anything there.
There's a bunch of benches back there. So I was like, I'll go check. Yeah, trust me, I was the sober one,
okay.
And everybody was giving me false information the whole night. But anyway, so I took my shirtless picture with Mr. Destructoid, and then I saw like a girl kind of grimace, and I was like, it was at that moment that I was like, this is gonna be a real bad photo later. Like, I'm not gonna want to see this. Why would I get
Did you get it with like the professional photographer?
Yeah.
So we're gonna see that later.
Yeah, I'm sure.
Oh, so that can be a header image on Destructoid.com.
I really hope not. Like,
all day.
If you Photoshop abs into it, it's fine.
That'll be like an all day just Zach shirtless every story.
April Fool's is coming up soon. That'd be a gag.
That would not make me feel nice about myself.
We need just a regular Thursday.
Dude, you can't even lie because you're on video and there's evidence. You're a buff ass dude. Like,
not in this section.
Oh, I'm Zach. I have nice hair. Look at the fucking bums I'm sitting next to. Like, this is some bullshit,
well,
man.
Yeah, but take off the shirt and everything falls back out. The girdle doesn't do all the magic anymore. So,
speaking of our lovely community that and all the people who love and support the site, who have made 10 years happen. We do actually have a few holdover reader questions from last week that we figured we might as well talk about now, because there was no call to arms to post questions. So, Triceratoc.
It's a good name.
Yeah.
Triceratoc wants to know, any of you guys have particularly embarrassing usernames, email addresses, and such from when you were younger, like XXX420GokuXXX or something?
That's a good question. I don't, though. My Twitter handle is Donsky3, and because that's like my nickname,
kind of,
and it used to be my like baseball number or whatever. Because
it's a little bit embarrassing, though,
because
to have a number
just
in your name.
Yeah, just Donsky was taken, though, and so yeah, I've had that since I was like 2007 or so.
Have you considered Donsky 420?
I feel like I've already built up this brand, which is a weird thing to say.
The Donsky 3 brand.
I used to have a Viking fan email address.
Like vikingfan@yahoo.com?
Yeah, but not Vikings fan, just Viking fan.
You only like one of them?
But the football team, not like the Nordic barbarians.
Well, I mean,
barbarians.
Well, that's kind of confusing then. Why did you not pluralize it?
Because I was like in fourth grade or some shit. I don't know.
You know, in fourth grade.
Fourth or fifth grade, yeah.
My only dumb name came out of a DuckTales episode. That was like my first screen name of some kind somewhere. But I don't even remember what it is. So.
Oh.
Bad story. Zach?
Mine has just always been Z-Zack. Like,
that's kind of embarrassing.
Yeah, no, I know, but it was one of those things where Zach didn't work. I was like, Zach 18. I don't know why I chose that number. Didn't work. Z-Zack 18. That's cool. I mean, that was just AOL Instant Messenger. Since then, I've just used my name for everything. So, and it works.
Fair. Occam's Electric Toothbrush wants to know, what was the last game you played that made you laugh on purpose? I got one for you if you guys need to think, because I was just talking about this recently, which is Headlander, which is a Double Fine published, or Adult Swim Games published, one of the two, and it's just actually funny. Like it's really embarrassing. I feel bad for a lot of games that try to do humor, especially because it often comes in the form of like stupid localization teams using memes. Which are already bad and are gonna also be even worse in like 2 months, and I get a lot of secondhand embarrassment for jokes that just really don't land.
Sure.
And I say this as someone who tells tons of jokes that don't land, but like at least they're
you
like,
don't say.
At least they're like original, you know. But if you're just gonna fucking like reference something, like if A, that's not a joke, and you know B, like just try harder, please, just. Do something.
So what he means on purpose, like they were trying to make
you laugh, like you were
not like Assassin's Creed Unity has some real dumb glitches. Nothing
yeah, but what
like,
if it's like a game that's like meant to open itself up to funny possibilities as far as like physics?
Well,
and stuff
maybe
like that.
Tell us about it, and we can.
Well,
I can tell you.
I don't know. I'm trying to think.
Is it
of
the
like
Goat Simulator?
No, I've never played Goat Simulator. I'm just trying to figure out the parameters of the question.
Zach hates Goat Simulator.
That is not what
that
I
is
said.
A hot take.
Fine.
I mean,
yeah.
A lot of people hate Goat Simulator, so
not
that's
hot.
Not that hot of a strong take.
Yeah,
I've never played Goat Simulator.
Yeah, I don't know. Funny games. I'm not a funny.
Stanley Parable is one for
seeker.
Me.
Okay, sure. Yeah, that was.
I'm trying to pull up like my Xbox account just to see like what some of my recent games are, because that's handy. But I can't figure out how the app works. Oh, here it is.
There are not a lot of funny games.
There aren't. Yeah.
Octodad Deadliest Catch was
sort of funny. That's what I meant. But that's like a physical comedy.
Sure, sure, sure. And that's fine.
Yeah.
And also Jazz Punk.
I haven't played it. I've heard
you should play it.
Yeah.
Okay. One more reader question. This one actually comes from me.
Oh. That's not a reader question.
I read all the time.
What do you read?
Books.
The Bible.
Playboy for the magazines.
Yeah.
For the articles.
For the magazines.
I want to know, have you ever known anyone that you have a strong opinion about, good or bad, with the same first name as a cast member on this show?
Like it can be a good thing, you said, right? Good or bad?
Basically, all Zachs are shitty people except for this one.
I pretty much agree with
Zachs
that.
And Trevor's.
Yeah.
And maybe
how many
Cody's.
Trevor's do you know?
They're all in prison. They burn things.
I don't think I've met a Trevor. I agree with you on Cody, though. I've never met a... Oh, well, no. We know
you
a good Cody.
You say Cody.
We know a good Cody.
Okay.
Cody's my brother's name, so yeah, Zach.
He knows a good Cody.
If you're a good Trevor, write in and let us know.
That's Darren@destructoid.com.
Oh, Roundabout, by the way.
Yeah.
I thought it was funny.
Oh,
funny
Jesus
games.
Yeah.
We're talking about people you have feelings about.
Okay, so Brett actually is one of my best buddies. Not this one. This one's all right.
Yeah,
I'm getting used to him. But no, okay. Brett Bergman. I met him at Home Depot, one of my coworkers, and he's just all around great guy, but kind of in the worst way possible. And that he's like a 6'3", really in shape, handsome guy who is good at literally everything, but is not smug at all about it. So it's like, I really like you.
Basket weaving?
Yes.
Underwater basket weaving?
No. Mm-hmm. Okay, not everything.
Esports?
Yeah, actually, probably. Ooh. Yeah, he's like this, like big, handsome as fuck, you know, buff guy who's like, I'm going to build my computer and I'm going to tinker with the knobs a little bit and know everything I'm talking about. And you're like, screw you, man.
Is this computer a ham radio?
Yeah. No, it's nipples. You just...
I feel like that this question was prompted by me having a strong opinion about somebody with one of your names, but now I don't know who that might be.
Well, could it have been Darren or Hayden or Jordan? Kyle or Jordan or Chris or...
I mean, it's...
Holmes? It's, do you know somebody named Holmes?
I mean, I don't think Holmes is on this podcast anymore.
He used to be.
But,
Teardrop.
Yeah, no, I don't got anything else.
All right, cool.
No. Actually, what I do got, though, is some more questions. More questions.
I think he thought you were going to say Sat Pod Pack.
I think you should try again.
Hey, everybody, it's time for this week's episode of Sat Pod Pack. Steven asks the people on the podcast the question. The game where I, Steven, ask the people on the podcast the question.
All right.
I'm going to go ahead and give you guys our rolling total right now. We have Brett clear in the lead with 9 points. Kyle, not present, coming up the rear with 7. Darren behind with 6 in third place. And Zach is down in fourth place with 2 points.
I've barely been on the show.
No, it's just that you're really awful.
You're
horrible.
You're a dumb person.
You're bad. You're stupid.
Got it.
Oh my God.
Intelligence is your dump stat.
Cool.
Yeah, I mean, if you didn't suck so much, we should be winning this game right now.
Okay, great.
Basically, what we're talking about.
You know, the problem is that since we're actually all in the same place for once, I can't quickly Google the answer, so I'm really gonna fail this. All
right. Brett.
Hello.
For a chance to get double digits. How far is one click?
Oh, shit. I feel like I should know this. A click is a nautical mile.
How far is a nautical mile?
It is 1.96 miles.
Buddy, if you have to ask, you can't afford it.
I'm going to see if you're technically right or not, but probably not.
I just said it confidently. I have no idea.
Now I've been exposed as an idiot. What the fuck is a nautical mile anyway? Why is it different than a regular fucking mile?
Wind resistance? No, I don't know. There's some reason.
A nautical mile is a unit of distance sent by international agreement as being exactly 1,852 meters, about 6,000 feet.
That's like a mile.
That's not a click.
Yeah, a little more, actually.
Well, producer has weighed in, and that is not a click. A click is not a nautical mile. A click is 1 kilometer. It's a slang for a kilometer. It's a click.
Okay.
Zach, your question this week. Right. If I can pull that back up again and get out of the nautical mile Wikipedia page. Zach. My wife.
Your wife?
Yeah. Good job, Zach.
Do I really get a point for that?
Yeah.
All right. I'll take it. Yeah, that's
you
like bullshit,
are now sitting pretty with 3 points, my friend.
Oh, he's actually putting it in his phone. What do? You just Google, email yourself
Google
every...
Docs.
Oh, a Google document.
Long running. Well, I mean, that has been this special edition,
you know what?
Live Podtoid.
No, I want to back up for a second. You did another set pop pack, actually, because you put in a reader question. So I answered that, and I talked about a Brett that I know, and you didn't really say a whole lot. So I feel like I should get another point for that.
Okay, see, here's the thing. I run the show. So no.
Okay, well, I thought I made a pretty good argument there for that.
No hot dish this week.
No hot dish this week. R.I.P. Darren, who doesn't want you to pee in his shower.
Darren passed away this week.
And in honor of Darren passing away, I have pissed in your shower 3 times this week.
Oh, have you?
Yeah.
Oh, Darren. Yes. See, this is the kind of these are the kind of people we want to commiserate with, to associate with, that we want on the show. We want proud, loud, and proud shower pissers.
Also, you're just happy because Zach pees in Kenny's shower, not your shower.
That's also true.
Wait, there are 2 showers?
Yeah, I have my own shower.
That's like, I was denied need to know information. I'm going to take a shower right now in your shower and piss.
You have to go through his bedroom.
That is fine. That's just an extra obstacle.
Well, I hope you've all enjoyed us being able to actually sit in a room with very nice mics set up by Kenny very graciously. And we've even got tape of this that you might be watching or you're listening, but it's actually tape. We're shooting on film. We're pulling out all the stops. It probably this episode alone probably cost $7,000 to produce.
What if Destructoid goes out of business because of this show?
I mean, worth it. If I can tell you something, we might.
10 years, no more.
But we had a good run. Thank you for listening to Podtoid. I'm going to enjoy my nice chillax floral shirt. And maybe go take a nap in a hammock. Do you want to build a hammock?
Yes.
All right.
Let's get on that.
Peace.